Hi, Jennifer.
Hey, Wade.
You?
How's it going?
Good to see you.
Nice to see you, too.
Sorry, I'm a little late.
Hey, no worries. Want to grab some coffee?
You bet.
All right. I see some over here. So I get to do that for CBC, and I also do some guest hosting for Daily Planet on Discovery
fantastic.
Channel.
That's
yeah,
great.
Like I'm really heartened by the popularity of these sort of science channels on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Things like, you know, ASAP Science,
it
Minute Physics.
Isn't it?
It's just a whole generational shift. So I think we're in good shape. So Wade, you're an ethnobotanist. Do you ever find yourself at parties having to explain exactly what that is and what it is you do?
I mean, I guess you'd say we just eat weird plants, but you know, I've always thought of myself sincerely as a storyteller. You know,
yeah.
I was really lucky that I studied both anthropology and biology, which was quite unusual back then, because mm-hmm. there was a schism between the two. You know, the anthropologists thought the naturalists were sort of elitist, and the naturalists thought the Indians were part of the problem.
Yeah.
You know, and I always felt that the same issue. Isn't this glorious?
I know, it's
amazing,
incredible
place
here. Yeah.
But I always thought that the issues that were afflicting culture were the same that were afflicting biodiversity,
mm-hmm.
and that you couldn't have one without the other. And so, and I also thought that those issues were so significant that it just wouldn't do to keep them within the academy, you
mm-hmm.
know, the silo of the university.
Where did this interest in culture come from? I mean, I know you're a BCer like myself. Was it something about our province? Was it something about experiences like this that surrounded you when you were growing up?
I was born in Vancouver, but I grew up in Montreal.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really thought about how I was drawn to culture. I think until a journalist asked me when I did the Massey lectures, and I remember that, you know, I grew up in Montreal when the French and the English didn't speak to each other, and my family lived in this Anglophone community that was kind of plunked like a carbuncle in the back of a very old traditional French village.
Yeah.
There was literally a road that divided the two communities,
yeah.
and on the corner of that road, there was a little grocery store run by a wonderful old Francophone couple. And my mom would send me down there to get cigarettes or milk or whatever. And at the age of 4 and 5, I'd sit on their stoop and look out across that road and think, wow, right across this road is another language, another religion,
world.
Another way of being.
Yeah.
Why can't I cross this road? I mean, not that my parents wouldn't allow me to, but my society sort
yeah.
of said, you're not supposed to cross this road. And that, I think, was the beginning, because I've been crossing those roads ever since.
If you'd gone back to, say, you know, little Wade back at grade one, you're 6 years old, the teacher asks everybody in the classroom, what do you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to be?
I said an explorer. I really
and
did.
You are.
I know. I mean, I my heroes were the Cour de Bois, Radisson, Grosseyer, and I would sit at the banks of the St. Lawrence and just imagine the canoes going by.
The canoes going by.
Yeah, look,
yeah.
yeah. And I think that was a big part of it. Let's sit down for a second. I think that was a big part of it. And you know, the other thing is that was so glorious about being Canadian then, growing up in the 60s and early 70s, is that in a way the society was set up to send you to the bush.
Yeah.
Everybody went to summer camp.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know, everybody had that seminal canoe
the cottage
trip,
at the lake.
The cottage
yeah.
at the lake, you know. And now we continue to love the idea of the North, but none of us go there.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, it was my generation, it was pretty easy to get a job as a park ranger
yeah.
or as an interpreter in the parks. I mean, all my friends who became key figures in our environmental movement in Canada all had that beginning.
Started
so I think,
there.
You know, I think it is true that you can look to landscape and find the key to character. You know,
mm-hmm.
culture does spring from a spirit of place. And I think that line of verse from Gilles Vigneault when he says, my country's not a country, it's the winter, really
yeah.
is true. I mean, you know, it is the winter that's the north that hovers in our imagination and sort of defines the national soul of Canada, even though we've become a thoroughly and predominantly urban country, you
mm-hmm.
know. So I think that was all part. And then the other thing that was very fortunate is that when I was 14, a schoolmaster of mine, a very interesting eccentric short man who had the, you know, scent of cologne and the fave veneer of a dandy, but all of that was betrayed by the scar on his face that betrayed, you know, showed a body that had been blown apart in the war. So
wow.
he was very interesting to me. And he took six of us to South America.
Huh.
And I
and
was.
Your family was okay with
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah.
yeah.
And I was 14, the youngest of the group. And the others are 16, and I think even 17. And I was very fortunate that whereas they were for the most part billeted with quite affluent families in the city of Cali, Colombia, I, by complete good fortune, was with a more modest family in the mountains, so I never saw any of the Canadians all summer. And they, for the most part, were terribly homesick, I was later told, at least some of them. But I felt, to the contrary, that I had finally found home.
Right.
And there was something in that intensity of the Latin family, the intensity of the relationship, the landscape, the presence of poverty and affluence, and a kind of a subtle understanding of the frailty of the human spirit, that, and just a vibrancy, you know, of life. You know, that you could actually be kissing a girl behind the bushes and dancing salsa with her mother the next moment, and the mother knew, and as long as, you know, everything's cool, as long as my son knows, you know.
Yeah.
And I just fell in love with Colombia, and, you know, Colombia is like my second home to this day,
yeah.
You know, I go to Colombia all the time. I've got a new major project in Colombia. And I'm actually working very hard with the Colombian government to help rebrand the country, you know, so that it's not seen as a country of cartels,
but
as a country of the most incredible biodiversity on the planet, which it has.
Well, how did you get from Colombia to Harvard? You started in the north, you went south, and you kind of ended up in the middle.
You know, I always, you know, make a big point to students that, you know, we tell them in school that life is linear, that you go from A to B to C. If you ask anyone who's lived an interesting and fulfilled life,
it's never a line.
It's never
a
line.
It's, yeah.
it's a series of serendipitous moments where you can only try to follow your inner compass and do everything you can to be the architect of your own life, which is actually the great creative challenge. But I epitomize that. I mean, I went to Harvard because I used to fight forest fires in the parks, and we were these obedient Canadian lads, and our camps were full of American draft dodgers who would tell our bosses to piss off. And it was just irresistibly charismatic at 15. One of them had the Life magazine of the Harvard student strike of 1969 on the cover. And I thought, that must be the school to go to become
That's
cool like these Americans. I applied, I got in, went down there, didn't know where it was, went to this African American guy at Logan Airport. He had a Harvard t-shirt on. I thought he'd know. He didn't know either.
I took my
trunk through the subway system and came up in Harvard Square in 1971. It was a madhouse, and my mom had made a mistake, and I was 2 weeks early. And the dorms weren't open, I had no money, so I dragged my trunk through the streets of Cambridge until I found a church, knocked on the door, pastor opens the door, welcomes me in, but he's a major war resistor, and his basement's full of weathermen about to escape to Canada. That was my entry to the United States. And then how did I become an anthropologist? The deadline for choosing was the next day, and by complete chance, I'd walked for the first time through a beautiful museum like this one, the Peabody Museum of Ethnology, and with my mind still whirling of these visions of shaman and costumes of the rainbow, I walked out on the street and I ran into a friend and I said, Stuart, what are you going to study tomorrow? You know, what are you going to declare? And he said, anthropology. I said, what's that? You read about Indians. And like Forrest Gump, I said, that'll do. So then I studied anthropology. But after 2.5 years of studying anthropology, I was sick of reading about Indians in books. Yeah. And I was in a cafe in Harvard Square. It's an absolutely true story with my roommate. And there was a National Geographic map right in front of us on the wall. And David looked at the map, and he looked to me, and he looked to the map, and he looked to me, and he suddenly pointed to the Arctic. And I had to go somewhere, so I watched my left hand lift, and it hit the Amazon.
Huh.
If it had hit Italy, I might have become a Renaissance scholar.
Yeah.
But it hit Amazon, and having decided to go to the Amazon at the age of 19, there was only one man to see, the legendary botanical explorer, Richard Evans Schultes, who had sparked the psychedelic era by discovering the magic mushrooms in Mexico in 1938.
Was he at Harvard?
He was Harvard. I mean, you couldn't be more Harvard than him.
Yeah.
He was this icon of the 1960s, but his politics were so conservative, he didn't vote for the Republican Party. He professed not to believe in the American Revolution. He always voted for Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth. And so I knocked on his door, unannounced, at his fourth floor Erie in the Botanical Museum, and I got as far as saying, sir, I'm from British Columbia. Well, he had spent all his career in Columbia, so he thought I was talking about that Columbia. And British is all, you know, a colleague once said of Schultes, the only way for him to go native would be to go to London. So I said, I've saved up money in a logging camp, and I want to go to the Amazon and collect plants like you did. I didn't know anything about biology. I'd never even taken a high school biology class. I knew nothing about the Amazon. And this man for whom mountains had been named in South America simply said, well, son, when do you want to go? And 2 weeks later, I was in the Amazon, where I stayed for 15 months on that first trip.
What was your first research project there?
Survival. I mean, I didn't have a plan. You know, it was one of those wonderful, you know, I had this botany idea in mind, but I was really, you know, on a quest for self-discovery. You know, I mean, it's interesting, if you compare my journals from that first trip, from a trip, but 4 years later when I was in graduate school, or you're getting, I mean, one's very professional, the other is just, you know, doodling, you know.
Yeah.
But my very first, I went to see, you know, Schultes had given me two letters that might as well have been written by God, you know. And I went to see this botanist at the National University in Bogota, and I knew he was about to take some students on a fantastic trip to the forest of the Darien, you know. And I asked him if I could go, and he said, "Man, I just had so much problems with my students. We've just had strikes. I just can't add an American student to the mix. It's just too volatile at this point." And I said, "Wait a minute, I'm Canadian."
Canadian.
He said, "Oh, in that case, come on." And I went, and
nice.
I went. And what was really cool is, I mean, it's incredible because we, you know, I had just arrived in Bogota, and suddenly there I was on the deck of this funky sailing boat, crashing through the waves of the Gulf of Urabá in the Caribbean storms, with dawn coming and the light of palm trees and islands just ran away to the south and Indians on the shore, and I thought I'd woken into a dream.
Yeah.
And I just did one trip after another, and then I was able to encounter and hook up with his protege, Tim Plowman, the greatest botanist of his generation. And Tim had this incredible grant, $250,000 to study a plant known to the Incas, a divine leaf of immortality. And this was coca, the notorious source of cocaine. So we had a brand new Dodge pickup truck. We had a dog, Pogo. And we had all this money to study coca and cocaine in the 1970s. I mean, can you think of a fun academic thing? But it was a serious project because, you know, cocaine hydrochloride is still our most important, as you'd well know, topical anesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the plant itself is used by millions of people every day. There had never been a nutritional study of it. We didn't even know the point of origin of something that had been used for 4,000 years in South America. So it was a really wonderful introduction, and Tim was a fantastic mentor.
You've had, you know, from the Amazon, experiences all over the world. You finished your PhD, and there probably isn't a corner of the world that you haven't seen. What are some of the different plants that you've studied, cultures that you've worked with in all of the little various
corners? Well, you know, I've been very fortunate. I sort of live by the adage of Marshall McLuhan, if it works, it's obsolete. And I never, I always resisted that, to a fault probably, that academic tendency to sort of become a specialist and encircle the wagons.
Here's my box,
You know, I've been 4 years in South America, and I've been very, you know, very intensely studying ethnobotany. I mean, I collected over 6,000 numbers. That's probably 35,000 specimens.
Wow.
Very precocious. But after a while, it just started to feel like collecting hay to me, and I realized I wasn't really a botanist, you know. And right at that point, Schultes summoned me to his office and asked me if I was interested in going to Haiti to infiltrate the secret societies and find the drug used to make zombies. Well, of course, I said yes, thinking that I'd be there for a fortnight, and it ended up consuming 4 years of my life.
Wow.
That book I wrote, The Serpent of the Rainbow, created a kind of sensation, and it was made into a Hollywood movie, a dreadful one, but a Hollywood movie. Doonesbury did a 3-week parody of it. It was on every news magazine. And I was driving around Boston with a friend of mine, a mentor, a professor from Brandeis, and Charlie said to me some of the wisest words I've ever heard. He said, "Wade, do you want to be a zombieologist?" And what he was saying is, do you want to spend the rest of your life digging up corpses in graveyards or chasing around Haiti? And I said, no, I laughed.
Yeah.
But I had spent 4 years on the project, written two books. I'd said everything I would ever want to say or be able to say, and rather than circling the wagons, I disappeared in the forests of Borneo and went to live with a nomadic Panan.
Yeah.
And I wrote an article for the Geographic in 1998 on vanishing cultures, and I stumbled upon the work of Michael Krauss at Fairbanks and Ken Hale at MIT, who were the only two linguists, really, virtually the only two then, that were really screaming about this issue of language loss, and they were saying, look, by academic consensus, half the languages of the world aren't being taught to children.
Yeah.
Which means, of course, that half the knowledge of humanity is on the brink of extinction. And I couldn't understand why the entire academic world wasn't screaming about that.
Yeah.
So I started screaming about that. And that's when I got recruited as an explorer in residence at the National Geographic, sort of as their social anthropologist, with the mission of trying in the decade to change the way the world viewed and valued culture. That was my literal mandate.
Mm-hmm.
And we realized that polemics were not persuasive, that politicians would follow but never lead. But this gets back to this idea of storytellers. You know, we had all these meetings with high-profile anthropologists, and, oh, we should have a conference, we should have a database, and our eyes just glazed.
Yeah.
And one day it just dawned on me, no, we're the National Geographic. We're in 165 countries. We have hundreds of millions of people following us. Let's tell the story of culture. And it was very much along the idea that storytellers can change the world.
Yeah.
And so I set out over more than a decade not simply to do the standard ethnographic tale of the exotic other,
mm-hmm.
but to take our audience to places in what I call the ethnosphere, the cultural web of life, where the practices were so dazzling that you couldn't help but come away with not just a new appreciation of culture, but a full embrace of the great revelation of Franz Boas, that
mm-hmm.
the other peoples of the world are not failed attempts at being you,
yeah.
they're not failed attempts at being modern. Every culture has something to say, each deserves to be heard. Each culture is an answer to a fundamental question.
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean to be human and alive? And when the peoples of the world answer that question, they do so in the 7,000 voices of humanity.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like a Lama once said to me in Tibet, you know, we don't believe that you went to the moon, but you did. You may not believe that we achieve enlightenment in one lifetime, but we do.
Yeah.
We do, yeah. And so that was what these journeys to the ethnosphere were all about, really paying attention to the fact, you know, something like ayahuasca, this hallucinogenic preparation that gets so much attention today. I mean, the interesting thing about this preparation is that it is a preparation, it's a combination of plants.
Yep.
And the active ingredient is a nondescript shrub which chock full of powerful tryptamines, 5-methoxydimethyltryptamine, dimethyltryptamine.
Yep.
Now these substances are powerfully psychoactive, but they're orally inactive because they're denatured by monoamine oxidase found naturally in the stomach.
So there had to have been a long process of experimentation to get
And it turns out the admixture is a liana, which has beta carbolines, which are harmine and harmaline, and those are MAO inhibitors of the precise sort necessary to potential. But how did they figure that out?
It was very
in a flora of 80,000 species of plants.
Yeah.
And you know, we say trial and error, which is a meaningless euphemism.
Yeah.
We don't. And the Indians say the plant teaches. You know what?
Yeah.
It's not that they're sauvage. It's that they're true natural philosophers who pay attention to that flora.
So, wonderful weather accepted. What brought you back to British Columbia?
Well, you know, this is my home, and the university made me a really wonderful offer. And, you know, I felt, you know, I've just turned 60, and I felt that if I ever was going to do for young people what my professors did for me, I mean, I really had a life forged by the fact that I fell into the orbit of two remarkable mentors, one in anthropology, one in botany. And, you know, I've lectured at literally hundreds of universities all around the world, and they've been wonderful encounters, but they've been so fleeting and tempting. The desire to actually, you know, work with a young student,
in
work with a young mind, in a relationship.
Yeah.
I mean, you must know that from being here at UBC. And I found it really uplifting. I mean, there's the energy that young people bring, you know, the enthusiasm. And I find the students at UBC to be incredibly bright, very hip, very open to new ideas, and so that it's been a real joy. And I also felt, you know, coming home to British Columbia, you know, I've been at the Geographic almost 15 years, and here's a place where culture is not some abstract notion, you know, it's not a political cause. It's all around us, and we're dealing with issues every day, and I love this country, and I'm very close to so many First Nations people, brothers and sisters of mine, really, I think of it that way. And, you know, so I just felt it was time to come home and be part of taking a stand for our country.
Welcome home. We're glad to have
Thank you.
So what's next on your research program?
Well, you know, I'm working a lot in the Sacred Headwaters in northern BC. That's where I have a fish camp and I'm very close to the Tahltan people. And I've also got a big project going in Colombia to do a series of books on the rivers of